Imer is professor at UNAM. He got his LLM at Harvard Law School. And since when, I'm a very good friend of him. So Imer, without further ado.
First of all, let me give thanks to both Thomas and Ronaldo. As Ronaldo said, Thomas invited me to a conference in Belo Horizonte, and we more or less arranged with Ronaldo the idea of coming down to Sao Paulo to give this presentation. So to start, I would like you to show a little clip of the Big Bang Theory. But let me just say something so it doesn't come completely out of the blue. Dworkin, as you all know, defends the one right answer thesis. So I will be talking about his legacy, and for me the legacy more or less can be summed up in that he provided a legal theory, a legal methodology for Hercules, for hedgehogs, and for one right answers. So let me just let Daniel put play.
I will propose a new topic of conversation.
Oh, great.
What is the best number? By the way, there's only one correct answer.
5,318,008?
Wrong. The best number is 73. You're probably wondering why.
No, no, we're good.
73 is the 21st prime number. Its mirror, 37, is the 12th. And its mirror, 21, is the product of multiplying, hang on to your hats, 7 and 3. Huh? Did I lie?
We get it. 73 is the Chuck Norris of numbers.
Chuck Norris wishes. In binary, 73 is a palindrome. 1001001, which backwards is 1001001. Exactly the same. All Chuck Norris backwards gets you is Siron Cook.
Just for the record, when you enter 5,318,008 in a calculator, upside down, it spells boobies.
Of course, I guess we can get this out of it. Of course, the 73 being the right answer, it depends on a whole different agreements or presuppositions that we more or less agree that making all this case for this being the best number, because it goes in different directions and so on and so on. But clearly, someone might think this is the best one, but I really believe that 73 is the right answer. I really buy the idea, and I repeat that the mirror is 37, and it's the 12 and the 27 prime numbers, and that 21 is the result of 7 plus 3. So I think he makes the case, and I think it is the right answer. If you are asking me about numbers, which is the best number, I agree with Sheldon. So of course, I will have to clarify that I don't think that this is because we are nerds and we agree with them. I think it's more complex than that. And so, at least my main point here is to give you the sense that there are right answers. So, for me, the idea of talking about Dworkin's legacy is about calling more to attention which was his aim, and which was the legal theory and legal methodology resulting from that aim. So, Daniel, do you think we can take this out? So let me just start by quoting or making by recalling to Dworkin's Taking Right Seriously to the introduction, where he stated clear which were his aims. And I would claim that the aims remained throughout the different years till his passing away in 2013. So he aimed to define and defend a liberal theory of law by being sharply critical of another theory widely thought to be liberal, the ruling theory of law, which has to parse and insist on their independence. The first part is a theory about what the law is, the theory of legal positivism, which holds that the truth of legal propositions consists in facts about rules that have been adopted by specific social institutions and in nothing else. The second is a theory about what the law ought to be, the theory of utilitarianism, which holds that law and the institutions should serve the general welfare and nothing else. Contrary to the insistence about the independence of the both parts, Dworkin claims, a general theory of law must be normative as well as conceptual. Clearly, Kent has made the point that his theory of law can be conceptual, but in another parts of his work, he can do the normative stuff. So that's Kent, not Dworkin. Dworkin is claiming that you can do, and can use the word conflate the two levels, the legitimacy and the legality, in following his example. But Dworkin does a little more than that, because he's not only collapsing the distinction between the descriptive and the prescriptive in law. So let me just say that its normative part must treat a variety of topics indicated by the following catalog. It must have a theory of legislation, of adjudication, and of compliance. Compliance will be more or less related to the coercion, but Dworkin, Ken was stepping into only the concept of coercion, not into the theory of compliance, the theory of obligation, that, and not necessarily justifying or going into a moral way. So that's a different part of that was not his paper. And as I say, I guess you can find different paragraphs in which Dworkin is using the normative and the descriptive, and he kind of connects these two things, and we will be coming back to this. But he further thinks that this integration of the normative and the conceptual will work not only in general theory of law, but also in other departments of philosophy. And I'm quoting Dworkin. The interdependencies of the various parts of a general theory of law are therefore complex. In the same way, moreover, a general theory of law will have many connections with other departments of philosophy. The normative theory will be embedded in a more general political and moral philosophy, which may in turn depend upon philosophical theories about human nature or the objectivity of morality. The conceptual part will draw upon the philosophy of language and therefore upon logic and metaphysics. A general theory of law must therefore constantly take up one or another disputed position on problems of philosophy that are not distinctly legal. So I guess it's clear more or less where we are. So I believe that if law was only a matter of description, we'll describe this as a glass of water, H2O, and anyone who disagrees with this will be crazy. But I think law is more complex than merely describing this. So it will have to be, do we have to secure a right for people to drink this anytime? So it will have a different approach, which will be prescriptive from a point of view. So in the paper, I make some distinctions between legal theory, jurisprudence, philosophy, and so on. It really doesn't matter. I just wanted to define the concepts I will be laying on using. And I decided to use legal theory, which it seems to be the more comprehensive one, and legal methodology to refer to the methodological part. So pretty much those two are the concepts which I will be using. So let me go into this second part of the legal theories and methodologies by showing the options we have around. And for that purpose, let me start by citing Hart. In the postscript to the concept of the law, he clearly says, "My aim in this book was to provide a theory of what law is, which is both general and descriptive. It is general in the sense that it is not tied to any particular legal system or legal culture, but seeks to give an explanatory and clarifying account of law as a complex social and political institutions with a rule governed and, in that sense, normative aspect. My account is descriptive in that it is morally neutral and has no justificatory aims. It does not seek to justify or comment on moral or other grounds than forms and structures which appear in my general account of law, though a clear understanding of this is, I think, an important preliminary to any useful moral criticism of law." So keep in mind this moral criticism of law, it will be helpful. I have already mentioned that following Hart, there's a general theory in contraposition to a particular but also that there might be descriptive theories in contraposition to prescriptive normative or justificatory theories. Clearly, Hart, let me make this, instead of an axis, make it a quadrant. So we have four options. So the, and clearly Hart is saying, my theory is a general and descriptive. So he's clearly making the case for one. Although he said that the description will be helpful for later on morally criticizing the law, which will be clearly doing the two. He didn't say much on how much he was going to emphasize in the particular system of the UK, but so we can focus hard mainly as doing one. So we have theories which are general and descriptive, general and normative, particular and descriptive, and particular and normative. When we are talking about the law in our countries, the positive law, the constitutional law of, say, Brazil, we are clearly talking here. Sorry, particular descriptions, if we are describing, if we are proposing a reform, an amendment to the Brazilian constitution, where we are clearly here. So let me just suggest that there's nothing that forbids us to make more general theories, which will be, for instance, connected one and two. We start with a general description, and then we make a general prescription. Or with three and four, we start with a description of the particular legal system, and then we come with a prescription of what reform we have to do. But also, we can also discuss and make the relationship between the particular legal systems and generalizing that to a general legal system. Or the other way around, starting with the general and seeking it to be presented in our particular legal system. So, and the other one I think we can also do is being completely into the prescriptive side and talking, well, in other countries they have already granted paridad de género, and we have to do this in Brazil. Completely into that side. The only two possibilities which I don't think are feasible, which will be fallacious, is like jumping from the one to four or from two to three. Because you will be committing a fallacy of is and not ought as is. So those are the problems I see. So this is completely ruled out. And nothing forbids us to make a more general theory which encompasses the four levels. So remember, Dworkin used to say a lot that he was only talking about the legal systems of the UK and the US, which were the systems that he knew. But of course, whatever he was saying, who might be starting here and here, was able to be generalized. And so I think he was making a broader comment, a broader theory in the general level. To what extent that, since I already mentioned, Dworkin collapses the distinction between the descriptive and the prescriptive, and conflates the conceptual with the normative, in the case of Dworkin, let me hold on a little bit. So for instance, we already said that Hart is here. Hart, Ras, Hima are in that enterprise. Let me just suggest that strong natural lawyers like San Agustin, when he says that unjust law is not law at all, he's clearly committed to this position, San Agustin. Dworkin, as I already hinted, is not making either this one or this one, but is somehow talking about the two, the interaction of the two. So he's clearly adopting somewhere, and we'll see where he's standing. I completely forget, we'll not discuss whatever the other people are doing in the particular level, let's emphasize with Hart, with the general level. So we have natural lawyers who can be making a very strong normative, general normative theory of law. And we have the positivists who tend to do this general descriptive. With the exception of probably Bentham, because here in this mainstream of the theory, we can also put Austin, Kelsen, Ras, him as I said, and most of the guys, positive guys. But for instance, Bentham, as you might remember, he had the expositorial jurisprudence here, and he had a sensorial jurisprudence over here. And he was more or less connecting the two, but he was like, first do this, and then do this. Schauer, for instance, does something very similar. He also goes into first describe and then prescribe. Again, Dworkin is not saying first describe and then prescribe. He's saying that the description and the prescription are very close together. So my explanation of what Dworkin does, especially if you also take into account that he's usually coding cases from the different parts of the world, the cases mainly of UK and the US, but generalizing them and even going into the decisions of the European Court in Strasbourg or the German prosecutor in Germany or a Mexican case, a Brazilian case, a Colombian case, because he was kind of able of adapting the examples to the places where he was going, I think he's clearly also including this part into his analysis. So the metaphor I think is the best to explain this is that Dworkin blurs the lines, the divide methodologically like these four, but still I think he has to be discussing in these levels, so I don't think he commits any problem or fallacy. And what he's done is only blurring these lines in a way in which he's able to talk all over the place. And of course some people will say that he's being sloppy, no, I think that's what he offered and that's what he's giving us. And I think he's basically right. That's what a general theory of law should look like. And I think it's very important to do this kind of comparison between the particular legal systems and the generalization. Take, for example, Austin. Austin talked about the general jurisprudence and the particular jurisprudence. He was thinking in this side of the descriptive part. And he will say, it is sufficient to look to the UK, to Germany, and to France, and that's it. With only these three particular legal systems, we can generalize what the law has to be elsewhere. I completely see that as a fallacy, because he didn't give enough support to his conclusion. So more or less, you see where Dworkin is? All over the place. So for enforcing or trying to present what Dworkin is doing, I have suggested that he has like four main parts in his methodology. And the concepts I use, and I would probably like to go a little fast to have more time more time for discussion. So first of all, let me say that his methodology to work in this idea of a bigger system has to be constructive. So let me clarify that. So Dworkin is clearly not being a natural law lawyer in the sense of thinking that the law is already out there, floating in the air, idealism, nor that it is physically out there like the tree I can see to the other side of the street. So he's not into that side of the spectrum. In that, he is actually more in the constructive side, in the art, law as an artifact side. In that sense, he's closer to the positives. And I think this is clear since 1973, when he did a review of John Rawls, A Theory of Justice, and which he criticized Rawls as falling within these kind of naturalist ideas of the theory of justice being out there and being either ideal or physical. And you know the thing, Rawls went backwards, and that's why he came with political, non-metaphysical, because he had to move away from these claims. He also became kind of constructivist, as Dworkin suggested. So the idea, for instance, of reflective equilibrium of roles, I think it's also helpful to understand in which way the arguments or the law is being constructed, because we are reflecting in the different arguments we are offering, and And please notice, we are always talking about the practice, a very complex social practice like law, but keep in mind that he's connecting the theory and the practice to the extent that he can say that the jurisprudence is a silent prologue to any theory of legal education, legal adjudication. So I hope it's clear that it's constructive, so it's not natural. You have to construct, and let me just probably I have to clarify this. So he can be constructive, and the answer has to be right there or out there, not in the either sense I suggested, floating in the ideal world, nor in the physical, real material world, but it has to be like it's already in the legal materials we have. In the legal materials and the legal principles underlying those materials. The legal principles that provide a justification for such materials. To the extent that in the Injustice for Hedgehogs, he's saying something that it is clear, something like this. There are legal norms, that's the law. There are legal norms that are being enacted. There are legal principles underlying. To the extent these legal principles justify these legal norms. To the extent that there are other legal norms, even though they are not, or they have not been yet enacted, but derive or can be constructed out of the legal principles that we already use to justify these norms. So they are already in place to justify these other norms. So for instance, one of my favorite examples, same-sex marriage. There was a legal norm justifying marriage. So which is the legal principle that justifies protecting marriage? I think it doesn't have to be with the definition of one man and one woman, but it has to be with the idea of founding a family, the mutual support and respect that the two partners need. And the partners need that respect, guess what? Regardless of their sex. So it can be two men, two females, and not only the original case of one man and one female. So this is somehow already the law. It is in the legal materials, but it's coming out of the legal principles that we have already used to justify these legal norms. So it's already here. So that's, I guess, part of why he is constructive. It is clearly not naturalistic in that sense, because it was not out there in either sense. He's constructing it from the legal principles, the underlying legal principles. The second idea is that it is interpretive. And this came during the question and answers to Ken. And clearly the distinction between making conceptual analysis, purely conceptual analysis, like having the concept, and what Dworkin does, that it has to be a more interpretive, a constructive concept. So it has to be interpretive as well. So constructive and interpretive may sound like a pleonasm, because they have that. But I think it's good to emphasize that we have to do those two in the same side. You have to construct and you have to interpret. So interpret still the idea that we already have the legal principles. I am not creating new law out of the blue. I'm only using the legal principles I have already there, interpreting them to see if they justify this, they also justify this. So I think it's clear that it's interpretive, but I would like to say something quick on the other concepts. So the other concepts have been typically considered to be criterial concepts, natural law, natural kinds concepts. And clearly, law has to be closer to something else like functional kinds, social kinds. But still, that's not Dworkin's idea how to label that. He will label it as interpretive concepts. Just to give you a sense, criterial concepts. A triangle is a criterial concept. It has to have, by definition, three angles. A natural kind concept, the H2O. A lion, we have to see which is his DNA, but we'll find it out and you will see, we can tell this is a lion and this is not a lion. This is a leopard, okay. It's close family, but it's a different one. And of course, law doesn't function like either one of those. And as I said, and Ken mentioned the example of the bachelor being an unmarried male. But there still will be some room for interpretation. And the example is, well, whether the Pope is a bachelor or not. my take on the answer to the Pope is that we cannot say that he's a bachelor. Somehow we have to say that he's married to God, or he's into some sort of very close relationship that forbids him to get married with someone else, and so on. He is not a bachelor. But still, what I'm trying to suggest is that even though we can sort some concepts in different ways, there's still room for interpretation, and what also Dworkin says, for disagreement. Someone might say, no, the Pope is a bachelor. If from the point of view that he's a non-married man, I agree. But some people, so this will be, we'll be having disagreements even in these cases and these examples, but I think we will be agreeing on, at least on that one. But it is important to keep in mind that sometimes the concepts will lead us into disagreements, and that's why they have to be interpretive. To what extent do you want to protect the fact that, that the water has to be available to every human being? And what about how much we want to pursue, for instance, a water war, like to get more water? So it will be justified or not, or what? How far? So that will be a discussion which I think it will be more of this kind of interpretation. Yes, clearly, if we are talking about what is water, H2O will be a nice solution. But I think it will be more than that required for working the law. And I have a different example. So I used the two, constructive interpretive. And the other one, the third one I would like to emphasize is evaluative. And Dworkin, more or less, some of the quotations go into the direction of saying, law is not descriptive nor evaluative, but something in between, something. And that, I think, what I would like to emphasize now, by now, is that, but it has to be or have this evaluative part. So we have to evaluate, so to justify, to legitimate things, we have to end up evaluating. So for instance, when I am discussing whether the concept of same-sex marriage within the concept of marriage, I am evaluating that it is a good thing to do, not to forbid the use of this concept to these guys, but because I think it's justified to move. So it's clearly that I'm also doing something evaluative here in the process. And finally, the idea of integrative. So Dworkin is also emphasizing this idea of the integration. And I would like to say that it has two parts why I think this is important, the idea of integrity. One is like the idea of law as integrity, and the other one will be the idea of the unity of value. I'm writing this down because otherwise I probably forgot. So law as integrity, that's one of the ways Dworkin formulated his theory at some point, especially in Law's Empire, in which he was kind of claiming that everything was integrated in the law had some sort of integrity. And the idea of the integrity will be that the legal principles which hang together I will use the metaphor of the bolinho. So you have the rice, the tapioca, the meat, whatever is in there. And if you try to only bite the meat, you'll be biting everything. You will be bringing all the principles. Okay. Whereas, as you might remember, rules are more or less valid in this change of validity. Whereas the principles are valid on itself and they don't depend on the change of validity. So these are, or can be said that they are linked, whereas these hang together. And so we have to, whenever we are talking about the law, we have to show both fit and coherence. And that's one of the ways in which I think we can see the idea of integrity playing for Dworkin or doing the job for Dworkin. So it has to fit and cohere within the practice that we are talking, which is the law. So it has to show this kind of integrity all the way. I guess, as I said, that the idea of integrity between the principles and so on, and that there will not be a conflict between them because they are more or less integrated in the same process, will be reinforced in Justice for Hedgehogs, in the unity of the value thesis, in which Dworkin wants to respond to all the different criticisms that can be made whenever we are talking about values. And so he is against those who are value skeptics, those who think that values are subjective, not objective, those who believe that values are relative and not universal, and those who believe that values are plural. And so he will have to bring a more coherent, integral theory of how the different principles work and how they are united on value to show that they are not really in conflict. And the examples are really hard, but I think he's more or less right. Without the more or less, I think he's right. In, for example, when in the discussion for abortion in the US, he was saying, well, I think it is wrong to put the debate as it is a matter of those who are in favor of free choice, or los pro-choice, and those who are pro-life. And his point is that those who were pro-choice are also pro for the privacy of the woman, for letting her to take the decision, the choice, the privacy. But they will also claim that they are also pro-life. Clearly, we are having a disagreement on what concept of life we have, because these guys will have a very broad concept of life since day one of the after having sex, or having sex in that very same moment, or 30 seconds, 1 hour, 3 hours, 1 day, 2 days, I don't know when exactly they have in mind, but they will defend that view of. And what Dworkin is saying, well, the life, it's also all the life, all the way. So having the project of life, of the woman being respected in making the decision whether she wants or not to bring her pregnancy to term, it's something that it affects her life, the life of his partner, the life of his other siblings. Imagine she has already 5 siblings and she's poor. Oh, yes, allow him to bring more kids into the world. That's what God intended us to do. So I think he's clearly like making the case that we can line up the different principles in the same side. And instead of having like these kind of views in which my positive friends, I tend to think that they like to put one principle or the other as if they were like rules. I have one rule here and one rule here, so which one of the rules has to win? No, I think we have to do this more complex balancing proportionality between the legal principles because they are integrated, they are united, they are the same realm. So more or less I think that's clearly for this. So the last section of the paper is on Dworkin's one right answer thesis. And I think his, as I said, it is clear from early on in his work that he wants to defend that position. He introduces the one right answer thesis in hard cases in 1974. So let me put it here. So he introduces the one right answer thesis in 1974 in hard cases. And he does the following. So bear with me for a while. I have spoken a little bit too much, but that last line of argument. So he creates an imaginary judge named Hercules, and I quote, a lawyer of superhuman skill, learning, patience, and acumen, who I should call Hercules, a judge in some representative American jurisdiction, who accepts the main uncontroversial constitutive and regulative rules of the law in his jurisdiction. That is, that statutes have the general power to create and extinguish legal rights, and that the judges have the general duty to follow earlier decisions of their court or higher courts whose rationale extends to the case at bar. So let me just put that. So Dworkin is suggesting that there's this guy called Hercules, and he's saying, well, he has a superhuman ability, superhuman capacity. He doesn't have time constraints. He has the best secretarios de estudio y cuenta. That's the way you would call it here in Brazil. Secretarios de estudio y cuenta, the secretaries that work for the justice. Law clerks, but law clerks. He has the best law clerks, the best asesores, and the best secretarios de estudio y cuenta. And so, and he has the best systems of information. He has the best everything. So this guy, Hercules, will reach the one right answer in any case? I'm asking you. With the characteristics that I have given you, let me just point to a brief thing here. So we usually, following Hart, we had this idea of the formalism, having like one right to every case. And on the other extreme, we have the skepticism to rule skepticism, the realist who claim to have as many answers as cases were there, and so on. So then Hart came with a middle position, saying, well, the formalists are right. There are cases in which there's one right answer. But there are cases in which, don't exaggerate, there are not as many as people. We can always, but yeah, there are several options open to the judge who will have to exercise his discretion. That's pretty much the big picture of Hart. But then the question, Dworkin arises, he's critic of the idea of discretion, and he says, well, instead of the judge doing judicial legislation, the judge has to appeal to the principles. And with the principles, he will be able to see which answers are not the right answer to reach like the best conclusion, the best justification according to the legal principles, and will come with the right answer even in the hardest of the cases, even in tragic cases, even in crazy cases, and so on. So let me go again. So if this guy, Hercules, has these characteristics, he has superhuman skill, capacities, knowledge, he has the best systems of information, he has the best asesores, he has the best information available, he has everything. Will this guy reach the right answer, yes or no? Which is your intuition? Yes or no? Okay, I have to say something more then. Clearly, he's talking about this guy called Hercules, this imaginary judge. He's not talking about any of the judges you know, that you touch. But the Dworkin's point, I think, is very subtle. He's saying, and I think he's right, that Hercules will reach the right answer. And what he's proving with that, it is that there are right answers. One thing is that we, human beings, without all these capacities, with all these, we reach or not that right answer. But the right answer is, at least from his argument, is already there to be constructed from the principles that we already have. You see more or less the point? So clearly Dworkin is not saying that all the judges are like Hercules. That's not what he's saying. He's not saying that all the judges always reach the right answer. He's not saying that. What he's saying is that there is a right answer. Even though we don't know yet which one it is, we don't know yet if Judge A got it right or Judge B got it right. I will claim that when we go to the judge, we go to the judge expecting him to do the right thing, to do the right answer. And I think we even criticize the judges with their decisions, and we point to them when they decided, and we think they went wrong, that they decided wrongly. So as pointing them to their mistakes. If they didn't decide this, we will say, well, the judge is crazy. It was obvious that was the right answer. So we are somehow in our system presupposing that there is a right answer. Otherwise, there will not be also a legal obligation. Because if the judge is going to decide at this point which are my obligations, I am in deep problem. It has to be that the law has already the obligations somewhere around. So in the process of defending his one right answer thesis, I think for me it is clear that he's not saying that the judges do reach it. Probably they never get it right. Probably sometimes they got it right. I think that's, but what he's making, the point he's making is that there are right answers. And at this point, in 74 and a little bit later on, 77, when he writes a paper called No One Right Answer, he's making this a defensive claim. And he's always saying something like, oh, I have to defend my argument of the one right answer thesis. I have to. So he will be keeping, like, saying something like, in the seamless web of the law, there will always be a right answer. Those who claim that there are no right answers in law, aesthetics, and so on, cannot be right by default. So we have to keep discussing. And I think that that's also true. Sometimes we think this is the right answer. But again, using this kind of the idea of the reflective equilibrium we mentioned, we keep going back and forth against our intuitions and our previous decisions to see if we are getting it right or wrong, when I'm right, when I'm wrong, back and forth, and criticizing previous decisions of the court. And finally, they got it right. So I think that's part of why he's right in the idea of the one right answer is. But let me insist on this, and I think that's the very important problem, which I think may be at the heart of your skepticism on right answers. He distinguishes between indeterminacy and uncertainty. Let me read Dworkin. But in all these aspects, indeterminacy differs from uncertainty. I am uncertain whether the proposition in question is true or false. It is plainly consistent with it is one or the other. But the proposition in question is neither true nor false, is not. So by distinguishing uncertainty from indeterminacy, so he can claim the law is determinate. There's only one right answer. And he's just saying that we are uncertain whether which one of the answers is the right one. And for that purpose of knowing which one is the right answer, we have to keep discussing and dialoguing which is the right answer, whether this was truly the right answer, or it is this one the right answer, or I think. I use one example. Poor Thomas will be the one here in this example for third time in like 2 weeks. and I will close with this example. That will be the last thing I have to say and explain. So for instance, Dworkin comes with this example, which is a variant of the one person, of the drawing Zimmer case, no? One person clings to a life preserver in a storm that has wrecked her boat. Sharks circle her. I'm running out of space, but here. Two other I forgot the sharks, and there are sharks. Two other persons hang to another life preserver some 100 yards away, and sharks circle them as well. And you can hear the sound. Tun 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 tun. So you have a boat on shore. You can reach one life preserver in time, but then not the other one. Assuming all the three are strangers, do you have a duty to save the two swimmers and let the lone swimmer die? And he comes clearly, and I can ask you again, which will be your intuition? You have to save the let's call him A, B, C. So you have to save A or B and C. What will you do? What do you think will be like your intuition? I think it's obvious that everyone will easily think that this is, I have to go and save these ones. But Dworkin says that we have to be more careful in that argument. And remember, I was saying since the very beginning that he was going to be critical from normative theory called utilitarianism, which is a consequentialist theory. So even though the two seem to be, so he will be criticizing that option. And as I said, he will defend, put it this way, he was going to defend a different normative theory. And as you know, he has been advocating for taking rights seriously. So he has to advocate for an answer that protects the rights. And of course, his arguments on rights were getting more sophisticated every time. He moved to the idea of equal concern and respect, to the idea of human dignity, and so on, so on, so on. So he was clearly moving into a wider idea of what rights are. But clearly, he did not subscribe a consequentialist utilitarian theory of law, which was the first thing he was criticizing at the beginning, which lines very well from a point of view with positivism, and he was going to defend a different theory, namely a theory of rights, a liberal-based theory of rights. So this is working. But if we approach the decision in another way, by concentrating not on consequences, but on rights, it is far from plain that we should automatically save the greater number. We might think that each victim has an equal antecedent right to be saved, and we might therefore be tempted by a lottery in which each shipwreck victim has at least one-third chance to be saved. The sharks, well, let me just, and Dworkin ends with this into parentheses, the sharks agree to circle while the lottery is conducted. So, just one more word. So, the fact that we are not automatically saving B and C and going, well, not necessarily going to A, but doing the lottery, we have to show equal respect to all of these three characters. So, we have to hold the lottery in which, if we put three different pieces of paper and we, and then we take the papers out, we'll find out we have A, B, or C, and we are going to save. Yeah, we are giving each one-third of an option of being safe. Yeah, I know clearly B and C have a better chance, but at least we will be respecting the chance of A. Otherwise, we will be completely neglecting a chance to be safe. And I know that the protocols in these cases of the Red Cross and so on are very complex, and they have to make this very quick decision. But clearly, it's not a matter of just saying there are more in this side or less inside. They take a different approach to this. And I think they are taking the approach to saving the lives, not just counting numbers or counting heads. Thank you. Obrigado.
Thank you very much, Ima. So in this panel, we are making a different follow a different protocol. My intention was to give more time for the ground, but I'll make a very important exception, which is let Ken speak before you, and then Ken move.
Yeah, this is a very quick comment. First, I just want to congratulate him for the comprehensive explication of Dworkin's view. It's absolutely brilliant. It was beautifully done. All right, now. There's a really interesting inference being made that a positivist would challenge, and that is from the claim that there's one right answer to the claim that the one right answer is already part of the law. Now, let me explain why a positivist would deny this. Dworkin distinguishes between legal norms and legal rules, actually. And the principles are norms. Rules and principles are both norms, so the distinction is between rules and norms. Dworkin distinguishes between principles and legal principles and legal norms, but he makes a really interesting claim about legal principles. He doesn't claim that legal principles have their force as law because they were promulgated by a judicial decision. If he did, that would make him a positivist. They're legally valid in virtue of their moral content, and that's what distinguishes Dworkin's view in part from the positivist. So, what a positivist will say in response to what Dworkin says is, and Emir articulated this just with such elegance and beauty, I can't begin to describe it, is this. Okay, if you take the position that there's one right answer and it's going to be grounded in legal norms as well as principles that are moral in character, yeah, there'll be one right answer, morally speaking. And there probably always is. Morality forms a seamless web. There's just no reason to think that that one right answer is part of the law. The reason that Dworkin takes that position is he thinks that moral principles have the status of law in virtue of content, which is the very thing that legal positivists still deny. So there's a gap in the inference. That's not to say that the position isn't coherent. Dworkin's position is coherent, and Emir did a beautiful job of expressing that. It's just that the positivist is going to disagree on the most basic level and say, look, okay, fine, if you want to bring morality into the picture, of course there's going to be one right and morally best answer, one morally right answer, but that answer in a hard case is not part of the law. It's the exercise of judicial discretion on the part of the judge to and to make that morally right answer, the morally best answer, part of the law.
Thank you.
So, if you could say your name, present yourself.
Never. It wasn't purpose. No, just kidding. Good morning. My name is Danilo. Professor, thank you for the exposition. I have a question. It's more like a proposition, a counter-argument. I'm going to use a little bit of what Professor Hemans uses, or one argument of Professor Hemans uses to criticize the example of the City of Angels. He briefly said that it's very hard to defend a position that is not, or defend an argument, an idea, a concept that could never be reached by humans. Therefore, if the right answer in the Arculus example is only possible to be achieved by a superhuman, there is no, or there would be no gain in getting this. Just because we know there is a right answer that we could never achieve, that would help us in nothing. Personally, I don't agree with this. I just think that's a good critic to make. But I would go to a different point. I would, instead of saying that Hercules has the best of the best in jurisdictional practice, that the argument is getting so complex that in some point there will be no way to get down. And even us humans can argument in this way. For example, we can use the slavery that was regulated, registered, and totally legal a couple hundred years ago in Brazil. And with the complex of many things, including jurisdiction and argumentation, the argument that it was impossible to continue in that state won in that way that nowadays, if we even bother to think that it was morally justified to come back with slavery, it would be destroyed. The argument would be absurd, even if our Congress is trying to do this, but it's a different question. And my point is, what is the right answer? What would be the right interpretation of the answer? The one that we can construct until the argument is so strong that nobody can destroy us, or literally is just an image?
Hello, my name is Daniel, and I have actually a question that I would like to hear you to talk about. What do you think that Dworkin would say? That it's a kind of a sort of an angst I have when reading Dworkin. Well, Dworkin does say that something counts as law if it's according to legal principles and morality and so on, political morality and so on, and his idea of the justification of coercion. But my question is the following one. What I would like to hear just more about this situation. Let's think that a tribunal court has decided something that is clearly morally wrong. Let's suppose that it's also a Supreme Court on a judicial review or appeal court, a court that actually has the final word regarding that case. And the court decides in a morally wrong way. The thing is, that decision will count as law. Everything that will be done from that point on, every decision and every kind of legal argument, you have to take that wrong decision into account. You need to ground your argument on that decision, even if you know that it's wrong. You need to say that you might, of course, have another ruling by the same Supreme Court later, but the Supreme Court will need to actually argue his case out. And it's a kind of a problem for me to actually understand how that's a thing that I have some problem in Dworkin's argument. How can we make sense of wrong legal decisions for Dworkin if they are actually sort of social facts at the same time that they are not? I'm not sure if I'm being clear, but that's a sort of an angst I have. Okay.
Hello, my name is Nuria. Nuria, see. I'd like to ask Dworkin's on the appendix of the Taking Rights Seriously, he was answering Hart when he said that if two different men, judging the same case and following his methodology, they would reach two different right answers. So I would like to know how this is possible in Dworkin, if there's it's ontologically right or something like that. Oh no.
Hello, I'm Luciana. I had the privilege to debate with Immer before, and well, I think your reconstruction of Dworkin's argument it's pretty good. I agree with most of it, although I would emphasize more the issue of the controversies in law, in the practice of law, and the disagreement, and the importance of that that description of the practice as a controversial practice and as a practice with a lot of disagreement to the construction of Dworkin's theory. I think it's only because of the disagreement and because of the impossibility to know the outcome of legal debates that Dworkin, for example, excludes law as a criterial concept, and for this he constructs what we call or what we can call of interpretivism. And I think that will be the point also to address this comment made by Professor Hima about the inexistence of right answers within the law, because for the working, I think how can I put that? I think the most basic disagreement that Dworkin has with positivism is that positivism is making a pure conceptual analysis, and that's what is not possible. He thinks because law is as an interpretive practice and a conceptual analysis of the concept of law would be necessarily a theory of political morality. And I think he's very clear about that in Justice for Hedgehogs, for example, the chapter about law. I think that's very well stated there. So, well, that was not my question. That was just a quick comment on what was said. And of course, I'd like to hear you both about it if we have the time. But my question is about the possibility of separating what we call the methodology of Dworkin's theory, what we can call interpretivism, from law as integrity. And I think we do not necessarily have to conflate these two, because for Dworkin, in my view, and I would like to hear about that, internal skepticism is always available. In the sense that, yeah, of course, we can reach a right answer and we can know there is some determination in legal argument, but we cannot say that internal skepticism is skepticism in the sense that, well, this practice is so bad that I don't have to say X or Y, I don't have a established answer to this legal question. I think this position is always available. And I think Dworkin constructs the integrity as an answer to that, and as an answer to legal pragmatism. So I'd like you to hear a little about this possibility of separating these two dimensions, because I think it's a possibility, but I have some doubts about that yet. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Katarina. I have just a quick comment, and a question actually. As you know, I work with the theory of private law, or philosophy of private law, as some say, And one of the things that I liked about the paper, I'm not a Dworkinian, but I liked the chart, so the general, particular, descriptive, prescriptive theory division. And I was wondering, but I wasn't sure, part two of your paper, when you talk about the distinctions between jurisprudence, philosophy of law, and theory of law, I'm not quite sure how this helps or in what sense it helps you with the methodologies, with, you know, constructing the categories. And because one of the things that interests me is how these normative structures of, well, these theories that talk about normative structures of private law, you know, as Weinrib or Jules Coleman's work, how are they connected to a general theory of law? So it's always puzzling that when I, especially Weinrib's, Coleman's less so, but Weinrib's, it sounds like it's hanging in thin air, his claims about corrective justice as the normative structure of law. And part of my research is to understand how this connects to a more general theory of law, that they are not really, it's not really explicit in their work. So your charts really help me, actually, to organize my thoughts about these theories. But I wasn't sure how these first distinctions, what relevance they have in the, you know, writing down the chart and making these distinctions between types of theories. So it's just a clarification question.
Well, thank you all. Great questions. So I'll try to do my best in putting them a coherent reply to all your concerns. So I guess it is clear that some people want to see law as only being in this part. Usually, those are the positivists. They claim to be making conceptual, general descriptive, and so they seem to be doing something here. Let me just say, for instance, Andre Marmor has said farewell to conceptual analysis, but we can still be descriptive and doing it in a different way. So they will be positivists by definition, will have to more or less remain here. But again, my feeling is that this is true if you see these two as separate parts, that we have a two system. And thus, I found that argument sometimes very schizophrenic, especially when I think of Russ. No? I'm talking about the law is here. But whenever I'm talking about content, substance, morality, that's something else. That's morality. So he's clearly holding a two-system view of law. So that's other questions. And I kind of have problems with, frankly, with that idea. I really feel like, oh, we are becoming schizophrenic. But so again, let me try to suggest that Dworkin is making all of this. And for the purpose of the argument here, the important part is that Dworkin sees, well, all, but especially the two levels, as not a two system, but as a one system. So morality is, or the other way around, law is a branch of political morality. So it's a branch of morality. So it's already, we used to think of law and morality probably as two overlapping things, but now we can see more like morality is this and law is this part of morality. The part that has been institutionalized, that is already in the legal norms, in the legal materials, in the legal rooms. So that's clearly, and what I'm saying from this suggestion is that it also includes whatever else we can justify that has already been used to justify legal rules. It can justify other common legal rules. So it has so he's clearly for a one system picture of the law. And so Dworkin, well, so one of the, that's like a general part, I still have to say more on Hima. But clearly by making a one system of the law, he's making the moral content part of the law. So it has to be like, and clearly Ken can stop short and say, well, I'm only working on this and I can do different. That's what all the guys are doing. What Dworkin is claiming is that we can do, or we have to do the two at the same time as part of one soul system. Will that change something? I think it does. And I have to put some of the examples, I think, following Daniela and Danilo, and probably also, yeah, I know I'm getting more chalky. So I take so let me move a little bit to Danilo. So the city of angels argument, the city of Hercules. No, that's not what Dworkin is saying. He is just pointing to the possibility, let me say possibility, that in somewhere in a jurisdiction, a judge with certain capacities will reach the right answer. What he's just, the point is that there's the right answer, regardless of the fact that our judges may be imperfect and may not necessarily reach that conclusion. But the right answer is there. And more importantly, I think we function presupposing that there's one right answer in the law. Otherwise, this won't work. We really have to believe that either killing is right or wrong. It cannot be either way. So in killing in a legitimate defense is right or wrong, but it cannot be like. So I think that's the part in which Dworkin is right, that there is no indeterminacy, regardless of whether we all agree or we are certain of which is the right answer. So I don't think the City of Angels argument applies to Dworkin in that sense, because I think it's a very different one. I like very much all the questions on slavery, healthcare, more or less Nazi law. It wasn't that clear, but I take that from Ken's idea also of it will be too unjust to be law, valid law. Let me show how I think it works, the different examples. And I have the healthcare example, for instance. Dworkin, in Justice for Hedgehog, uses both slavery and Nazi law. And he's saying that if we have like the two-system picture, we'll be like, well, this is valid law here, but it is too unjust here. But he would like to put them together. And he will say that slavery is valid law, but too unjust to be enforced. He will say, on the other way around, the Nazi law is too unjust to be enforced, to be valid. That's what he says literally in Justice for Hedgehog, but I think he's making two different ways of the difference, of valid law and unjust law. But how, I think that's a nice move. If we move to the one system, we will be getting better answers into that questions. And that answer resembles me Aquinas. When Aquinas says, non lex sed legis corruptio. So it is not proper law according to this standard, but it's a corrupt form of the law. It's already law, it's valid law. We have to change that, we have to move away from it, but it's still part of the law. Although it is not the proper law, the best law. And so I think the one system view will be much more helpful for us. And the example he also used is healthcare. And I think that will be also helpful for answering a little bit of Nuria's question I'm not sure of the paragraph. Sometimes I have read so many things, I'm not sure who is telling who what. So I will probably have to reread that paragraph to see if Dworkin is really saying there are two right answers. Sometimes he's saying that's the argument someone else is putting, and it's not necessarily that he's endorsing that. So that's my take on that part. But let me say that on the healthcare example. Healthcare, in previous works of Dworkin, in Matter of Principle, for instance, he's saying something like, well, healthcare is a great thing. It's a great idea, universal healthcare. Who will deny the idea of having healthcare? I guess no one. As Ken says, if you believe that it's not a good idea, you're crazy. But not in that example, but let me just use you as my shield.
Thanks. The bullets hit me. Yes.
Yeah. So let me go into the health thing. So he's saying, of course, it has value. It has worth. It's clearly a moral principle somewhere, but it doesn't fit my legal system. It doesn't fit the practice in my system. So can I go all the way because it's a great thing to be done? And he also has these distinctions between legal rights and legislative rights. Legal rights that are properly enforced by courts and legislative rights that will require a further piece of legislation. And guess what? in this example of the healthcare, he will have to say, well, I cannot make a decision because I don't have the legal, there is no legal right, but I guess there's a legislative right to the Congress to legislate in this subject. So it does also, just to clarify, that Dworkin is not willing to always step into the judicial process, like the legislative process, like usurpate the judicial mandate, the legislative mandate. He would like to respect that, and some cases are better answered by the legislative. Other cases are properly enforced by the courts. So that's, I think, a distinction important. And again, I think there are truly cases, take my example of the swimmer, of the swimmers, as being really two good answers. Saving one or saving two, both are saving anyone would be the right answer. But making the decision to try to respect the rights, I think that's much better answer than just going directly because two are more than one. Because there's something we forget here. It is not that there are two lives here. Well, the value life, it's in both sides of the equation. It is not that two lives are more than one life. It is life, and here you can say life, one life plus one life is still the value of one life. So it's life against life, or somehow it's in the two sides. So again, and I can more or less kind of argue that the right answer will still depend on the whole information we have. We don't have sometimes the whole information. So we have to make decisions without having the complete information. So we keep back and forth arguing for and against the conclusion we reach because of how we process the information. So I think that's part of the key, that even though there are two really good answers, one will be much better. And I can show you another clip if that's necessary to prove to get the point. So as you can see, Daniel, I don't believe that Dworkin is claiming to have the final word or that judges should have the final word. I think he's very respective of the institutional practice called law, on having courts on one hand, legislatures on the other, things that are properly enforced by courts, things that should go to the legislature and public officials, and going back to the citizens. And so, and he holds a very democratic, from a point of view, conception of everything called the partnership conception. So he's clearly not taking like the majoritarian conception, which will be also clearly to this side. Let's find numbers and make decisions. So I think he's also like a, that's somehow what I take from your final word comment. And also, there are mistakes? Yes, of course. Most of the times, most of the decisions, we get it wrong, and then we are committing a mistake. The law, yes, because I say it's this, the law says, for instance, X, and it's within the law. Until we reach the conclusion that X is actually outside the law, and that the correct answer was Y. And we expulse X from the legal system. And that's one of the reasons why I think it is good to have judicial review, constitutional review, to figure out which norms are not coherent with the whole system. So somehow I think that also goes into what Luciana is concerned. There are disagreements, yes. And Dworkin is actually the one that pointed, hey, you know something? We will be disagreeing because we will be aiming to the one right answer, but different persons will be reaching different answers. And we will disagree on who has the better answer. Again, the process goes to the importance of the discussion of the justification of which principles are the best ones. And I can take, well, the decision of the court to authorize gay marriage in Mexico was too much, was not too much, was wrong, was right. I think it was right, because it was already in the legal principles that I saw in the legal system. And so extending that concept to same-sex partners, I think that makes completely sense. And I don't think we are creating new law, nor, I would say, changing the law, but only recognizing that that's the coherent way of understanding the law all the way down, to the extent that, for instance, going back to your example of slavery, I know that people tend to think that in Greece, it was the way we had slaves. It was okay. Especially if you're Aristotle and you have time to philosophize, it's really nice to have slaves to do the work and you can sit down and relax. Okay, in the US, in Latin America, Mexico, Brazil, so, oh, slaves. So they were okay at that time. So that's one of the relativist arguments. It was right in Greece. It was right in Mexico, in US, in Brazil. It's not longer right. Let me say something. I think it has always been wrong that we got the wrong interpretation, the wrong ideas, that we were kind of justifying slavery to be part of our legal materials, when actually it was not. So I think we are only recognizing an error and mending the way by moving away from slavery, for instance. So it take it all this constitutional review. It's the law. Yeah, it was a corruption of the law, but still valid law. We had to push it away because it was too unjust, especially if we are holding like a rights conception of the law, as Dworkin does. So clearly, the slavery will be wrong from day one. And Aristotle will be wrong since day one. And so I'm pretty much, the separation of metallics, you wanted to say?
Aristotle was not Hercules.
Yeah, no. And he was clearly believing that some things were out there. Yeah. And he justified slavery as, it's out there. So yeah, don't get me too excited into criticizing Aristotle. So on the separation of the mythology, actually, I didn't think it in that way, but the distinctions I'm making on constructive, interpretive, evaluative, and integrative are somehow an idea of trying to, because I have the feeling that some people say, Dworkin is an integrative. Dworkin is an evaluative. Dworkin is a constructive. Dworkin is an and somehow I had a feeling that we needed to emphasize the different levels of the methodology. So I'm not sure I am separating the methodology. I'm probably only just emphasizing that they has like these possible four lines or trends within his legal methodology. And I think and for instance, let me just say that at some point I was like thinking of evaluative is already into interpretative in the integrative, but I still have the feeling that I have to emphasize that to keep as another of the parts of the methodology. So, but I don't think I'm necessarily separating them. I think it's only a matter of trying to emphasize the different levels of what he's doing.
Okay. Well, thank you very much. I think it's time for us to stop, unfortunately, but fortunately for our stomachs, we can do some treat for it. So, but before that, I just would like to thank you both, Ken and Immer, for coming here to have all this enthusiasm and patience to discuss with us. It has been a privilege to make another step towards this international conversation. And also another step towards strengthening this international community on legal theory. And I'm sure that this will also be very important to put us together in joint projects, to meet again and to meet other people again. And in saying this, I would like also to make a special thanks for Thomas, who has been very helpful, very generous during all his time here, and to bringing together many different projects and inviting Immer and Hima, and also showing us that different institutions can work together, like UNAM, like University of Washington, or here in São Paulo, especially University of São Paulo and Fundação Getúlio Vargas, who will be doing many different projects next year together. So thank you again. It has been really a privilege. And I think it's time to stop. Thank you all for coming.